Hello, coffee drinkers. Thank you for all your questions via Instagram yesterday. Let's get today's Q&A vlog started. Ben Walker Fitness asks, any advice for someone going in to make their first record as a band leader? My advice, based on personal experience, is be completely okay with the fact that it might not end up being your first record. Let me explain a little bit. Mystery to Me was technically and officially the first record I put out in 2004, I believe it was, back into 2004, but it wasn't actually the first record I recorded as a band leader. I did four or five before that, but decided they weren't right, or I could do something better, or I just wasn't ready to put out that material as a band leader. So be prepared for the fact that it might not actually work out. And if you go in with that attitude, plus being completely as prepared as you possibly can with your playing, with your writing, with your arranging, with the band, and if you go in with that attitude, it might take a little bit of the pressure off you. And if for some reason you don't like the outcome at the end, you might be able to just let it go and then move on to the next thing and find what your first album is going to be. And if you're not under pressure while you're doing it, perhaps that will mean the process goes really, really well and you'll just come out with a fantastic product. Blanditos Churritos writes, did classical guitar influence your bass playing in any way? Absolutely. It's a fretted stringed instrument. The technique transferred over very nicely. It was nice to put all of those years of practicing classical guitar, to be able to put all of that practice time to work on the electric bass immediately. And absolutely, when I look at the way I play chord melodies and I play a root note and a melody note, that absolutely was a big influence from classical guitar. Dom Kingsford asks, will there be an Australia tour anytime soon? Would love to see you. Dom, I would love to come back to Australia. It's been a few years, so I would definitely love to do something. I'm not sure if it's going to happen before the end of this year. If there is a legitimate offer, something that I can actually act upon, that you or perhaps somebody you know can put into motion before the end of this year, I have no problem in committing to buying a ticket and coming down to Australia to play some shows. But that really would depend on there being a legitimate offer and them being able to set aside a week. But it's not like Australia isn't planned for the future. I just don't know exactly when right now. Kuba Podvici, I think that's how you pronounce it, asks, how much time do you spend on transcribing solos or tunes? Well, that has changed over the years ever such a lot. I will say that in the beginning, and I have, rather conveniently so, I have sitting next to me some, just a few of my scrolls of my transcription books, which are just chock full of exactly what you're asking about, solos and songs and chord sequences and everything like that. But like I said, it has changed vastly over the years. In the beginning, I was transcribing a lot of vocabulary and working that into my practice routine because I had time. I didn't have gigs. The older I become, the more gigs I have, or the more responsibilities I have outside of my practice time. So that the amount of time I'm able to dedicate to that becomes a little more compact. So I wouldn't say I spend a huge amount of time doing it anymore, but once in a while something will really pique my interest and I'll go and you know, grab the book, grab a pencil and start transcribing it and trying to find a way into my vocabulary and into my playing with that new language that I'm hearing. Tuba Josh asks, why isn't Chelsea Afternoon on Spotify? Chelsea Afternoon was just a jam at the Artist Loft, the Aguilar Artist Loft in New York. We were shooting a product video for Aguilar, and that was a jam that came out of that. I didn't even name it Chelsea Afternoon. The Artist Loft happens to be in Chelsea in New York. We were shooting in the afternoon, and I think Dave Boonshoft gave it the title Chelsea Afternoon, and that was before I met Chelsea as well. So it's not a released song, and that is probably why it's not on Spotify. Kevin St. Noy asks, how have you been able to balance all that touring and getting married? Let's see, with great difficulty would probably be the quickest and the most honest answer. I just got back from Chicago. That was the final bit of traveling I'm doing before we leave for the wedding in just a few days to Europe. So it's the whole thing is a balancing act. Life in general is a balancing act, regardless of whether you're a musician or not. And perhaps it's slightly more logistically complicated for musicians who travel a lot, but I have an incredibly understanding partner. And I also like to stay home. I'm not a huge fan of being gone all the time. Don't get me wrong, I love to travel. I love to perform. I love to go to different parts of the world and visit. But if it's really a long time at a time, like a really long stretch on the road, I'm not a huge fan of that. So 5 to 10 days is the perfect time for me. That's not always possible. Quite often tours end up being at least 2 weeks, sometimes 2 to 3, but 3 weeks is really my maximum. So if I can keep it, like I said, 5 to 10 days, perfect. 2 weeks, pushing it a little bit, 3 weeks, absolute maximum, and then I can't do 3 weeks kind of back to back. So that's generally how I look at scheduling my traveling and trying to spend as much time at home as I can. CJ underscore Arc asks, what are the best records to listen to / transcribe to work on walking bass? Well, first of all, I can recommend certain upright bass players who I really look up to and who I got a lot from transcribing. Of course, people that fall into that category would be people like Paul Chambers, Leroy Vinegar, Reginald Veal, Christian McBride, Rodney Whittaker, Christopher Thomas. I know I'm missing a ton. I probably said Paul Chambers already, Ray Brown. There are incredible upright bass players and walking line vocabulary out there to transcribe. But I would say the most important thing about choosing which record to transcribe, which artist, which bass player to transcribe, is how much they inspire you. And Paul Chambers inspires me a huge amount. And then there are some people who don't inspire me as much. So I spent more time and got more out of transcribing the people. And this is not just for walking bass. This is for everything I'm listening to. I get more time out of learning music that inspires me and that I'm really having fun playing. I think that is the key, rather than the specific bass player or artist that I should probably recommend you transcribe. David Nevitt Bass asks, what do you include into your practice to help prevent injury? There's nothing specific, there's not like one thing I say, oh, I have to do this every day in my practice that's specific, that's tangible. The most important thing to me is the relaxation and the breathing and not putting any of my limbs under stress while I'm practicing. So if you've seen any of my videos, you'll take a look at my right hand technique, and I don't have the right hand, the wrist bent, my plucking hand bent like this at a right angle. The wrist is really straight and it's super relaxed. I don't dig in all the time. I'm not playing at one dynamic level all the time with the right hand. And also my left hand is very relaxed at the same time. It's all about the posture, all about the seating position. Even now, you can't see how I'm sitting, but both feet are flat on the floor. I'm sitting on my couch here. I'm very relaxed. I'm upright. I'm not slouching. My spine isn't bent in the wrong direction. And I do tend to sit more often than not while I'm practicing. So I'm not putting too much stress on the shoulder, and the bass is over on the left leg. So I wouldn't say there was a particular exercise or a particular thing I always add into the practice room every day to stay injury free. I would say it was an overall concept of being completely relaxed and having great posture and basic technique while I play. Lukasz Miszysz, I think that's how you pronounce it, and I bet you're Polish, asks, do you have Polish roots? Yes, I do. My grandfather on my father's side was born in 1910 in Stary Dwór in Poland. I'm sure you know where that is far better than I do. But yes, I do have Polish roots on my father's side. That's how come I have the names Janek Tadeusz Marek Gwizdala. Ale Drums asks, how do you keep yourself motivated to do things? Bass, sports, vlogging, etc. Well, the vlogging, not so much these days, as you can tell. There's a lot of time elapsing between uploads, but that's not to say I'm not doing a ton of other stuff or that I'm not motivated to do a ton of other stuff. When it comes to music, I'm incredibly lucky that I love what I do. There's no way around it. I think to be happy in what you do and to be motivated and ultimately be successful, and by being successful, I mean enjoying what you do for a living, I think you have to love what you do. And that's me. That phrase encapsulates everything I am about music. And so there's never really a problem for me to be like, okay, I got to get up and do this and I don't like it. And if there's ever any doubt about whether I want to play or not, I leave it. I give it a rest. The rest is way better than forcing the issue. So I generally have no problem with motivation. That also goes for sports, like you asked. I like to stay in shape. I don't like to feel that kind of lethargic, tired, unmotivated feeling. So I know that by working out and by exercising regularly and eating well and taking care of myself with nutrition and hydration, these are all things that promote happiness and just make my life a lot more fun. So it's really easy in that sense for me to stay motivated. Okay, Monsieur Larousse writes, when did you meet Steve Smith? He's just one of the best musicians in existence, in my humble opinion. Yeah, he is an incredible musician. He has become a great friend, and I met him through Mike Stern. I met him many years ago touring with Mike Stern and Randy Brecker as a quartet, and we have stayed in touch since, and we're just working together in Chicago for the Drum Fantasy Camp, where he was featured alongside Dennis Chambers and Chad Wackerman and Gergo Borlai, and I happen to be the bass player in the house band for all of those guys for their concerts, and then for some teaching stuff and clinics throughout the week. So always an amazing hang with Steve, and we just got to play Journey's Don't Stop Believing with Steve. I will try and post some video of that in an upcoming vlog, because it was so much fun. And it's never a dull moment with Steve, with the time, with the sound, with just the musicianship and the kind of the depth and the history and the music. I'm always learning something when I'm hanging out with Steve, so I'm very, very grateful for that relationship indeed. Jay Mantis asks, tips for soloing over top 40 songs in a party band. Feels like no one cares unless it's slap. Yeah, well, my number one tip is don't ever do that. Don't ever be in a playing a song, like playing a pop song, and then go and take a bass solo. It's completely inappropriate, especially if you're at a party where people are dancing. And that is generally what music was kind of originated for. And in that particular situation is normally what it's all about. You're playing a cover band, you're playing pop songs, you're playing stuff that everyone knows, and hopefully everyone is out there on the dance floor digging what you do. Your job as a bass player is to keep the pocket, keep the groove, along with everyone in the band, of course. But there is something that happens when the bass disappears. A huge part of the foundation of the music disappears with it. So playing a solo, big no-no for me when it comes to playing top 40 music in that setting. Austin Bass 2112 asks, what are your thoughts on pedal switches? I don't know just yet, but I am very curious. I'm thinking of trying out the Boss one. I forget the model number, but I am curious about having a switching system on an actual pedal board and not just carrying the pedals around in a random camera bag. So stay tuned for more information on that. As soon as I get that going, I will post some video about it. Kirsanov Serge asks, it's a bit weird, but why do you play music? I don't think that's weird at all. That's a really good question. It's also really difficult to answer, but I would say looking back on it, and number one, it makes me happy, and number two, I think it saved my life in a lot of ways. Obviously, I didn't start out playing music, at least not consciously, because I thought it was going to save my life, but it really has. It's given me a huge sense of purpose, and I've found something that I love to do, that I've become better and better at, and am able to operate on such a level where I'm loose and where I get to be conscious of everything that's going on around me and be kind of free within that music. And in that sense, that's a huge life-saving thing for me. Claudio Suriano asks, do you haven't practiced or studied enough? Absolutely. I always feel that I haven't practiced or studied enough, and that is the beauty of what I do, what you do perhaps, what we all do here as musicians, is there is no such thing as practiced or studied enough. It's never ending. I'll be hopefully into my 90s, maybe I'll even make the big 100 at some point and still be looking for something to work on and something, you know, still be looking to try and find something new in the music. Ferenc David asks, and this is a great question, I think, how do you keep yourself in shape when you have no gigs, or maybe it's never happened? Well, it happens all the time that I have no gigs. I'm not known as the most gigging musician or gigging bass player on the planet. I am no anymore, I should say. I used to work a lot. You know, there were years where I would play 300 or more shows in one year. That is not the case anymore, and long periods of time do go by where I don't get out and play live. You can go to my Spotify and follow me on Spotify, and there are a couple of public playlists, three or four maybe, of practice set song lists. And I'll basically put 20 songs, pop songs, in a playlist that maybe make up an hour or an hour and 15 minutes, just like a normal set on a gig would be. And I will play along with those. I try and do it so it's working on my ear as well as my stamina of simply playing music for an hour and 15 minutes and really sticking to that framework of a set. I'll also put in songs, mainly songs that I've never played before, so I'm working on my ear as well as my stamina. And by working on my ear, I mean if I've never played a song before, I want to jam along and find out what's going on in the first verse and the first chorus. And by the second verse, after the first chorus, by the second verse, I want to know the song. Like, that's the goal, to be able to pick up the song within a verse, hear one verse, one chorus, and then have it. So I'm working on my ear, I'm working on my stamina, and that, it absolutely doesn't go all the way. It's not the same as playing a live show. There are no other musicians. There's no energy from the audience, but it does help a little bit in terms of my stamina. And I'll do that a few times a week just to kind of fake, if you like, having gone out and played a couple of sets. Stringways asks, hi, is there any tennis happening with your back issues? Get better soon. Yes, thank you for asking. Back is all better and feeling great. And I'm back playing tennis, back working out. I'm in motion again, which is a great thing after being out for 10 weeks. So thanks for asking. And yes, back injuries are thankfully, right now, fingers crossed, a thing of the past. The Unofficial Barrett asks, what are some ways to internalize music fast? If I were to give you one tip about that, and let's put it in the context of pop songs, songs that have verses and choruses, possibly a bridge, they have lyrics. To me, it's about form. To internalize the form of the song and know where it's going, and then pick up little key elements, little markers of like, oh, there's this lyric, and when this lyric happens, we're going here. Or when this lyric happens, there's a minor chord. Or when this lyric happens, there's a major chord. Just picking up little keys along with being with having a good grasp of what form is, especially pop music form. I think that's a really important basic starting point when you're trying to internalize music fast. Gareth Creed Bass asks, really missing the podcast. Any plans for more episodes? Yes. Once the wedding is done and we're back in LA and there's some time to sit down and record some episodes, absolutely, the podcast will make a comeback very soon. Alicio underscore music asks, any suggestions for a good camera to vlog / record a gig, not too expensive? You know what? I used the Canon for the longest time, the 70D or 80D, whichever one it was, with a Rode Video Mic Pro for the audio. I have been using, as of late, these GoPros with the little clamp. Which are GoPro Hero 5 Session. The session is the thing. That's the important thing because they're tiny. If I pop it out of the housing here, they're this little cube. I'm not sure how much they are. I think maybe under $300, but don't quote me on that. But what they do is a great job of simply archiving gigs. That's what I use them for. I wouldn't use them for vlogging. They don't have a monitor that sticks out so you can see what you're shooting, and the audio for speech is not that great. But in terms of archiving and recording your gigs and being able to listen back to what happened on your gig, I think they're a great tool. Roskia Kalanonen asks, have you ever tried winter swimming while visiting colder countries like Sweden in winter? I have tried like the polar plunge or the Arctic plunge. I haven't done it outside of the US. I've done it on the east coast of the US in the winter. And if I'm guessing you're asking because you've seen me post about taking ice baths on a regular basis, I'm a huge fan. I'm a huge fan of Wim Hof. I'm a huge fan of Laird Hamilton and Gabby Reese and all of those people who use cold for circulation and for, you know, engaging the system and waking the brain up and all of that kind of stuff. So yeah, I'm a huge fan of it. And if I find myself in Sweden in the winter again, I will absolutely take part. Miguel MM97 asks, hi Janek, have you ever been influenced by any classical musicians? Love your music. Miguel, thank you very much for your question and for checking out the music. Yes, classical music is a huge influence on me. I would say I could probably tell you more about composers that I have been and am influenced by rather than specific classical musicians and soloists. But off the top of my head, I would say one of my earliest memories of classical music is listening to kind of Itzhak Perlman records. Definitely Maxim Vengerov, and yes, you've totally got me. I mean, I have an extensive classical music collection. Evgeny Kissin, I think, was a I listen to ever such a lot, playing a bunch of Chopin. But I'm a huge fan of Mahler and of Brahms and of Rachmaninoff and modern composers, Messiaen, Scriabin, romantic composers, classical composers. And it's really such a deep subject. I couldn't do the answer justice in just a couple of minutes here in the vlog. But yes, to answer your question, very much influenced by classical music and classical musicians. We are going to close out today's Q&A vlog. Epically long Q&A vlog. I hope that's cool with you guys. I want to try and get to as many of these questions as I can. This thing would be 3 hours long if I went to all of them and really gave them super in-depth answers, but hopefully this works for you guys. And I'm gonna close out today's very long Q&A with a question from my good buddy, Gabriel Santiago, who asks, very simply, who are your five biggest influences on bass? Holy cow. Almost an impossible question to answer. It's one that gets asked ever such a lot. And who knows, maybe some of the answers I'm gonna give you right now they may even surprise you a little bit. I'm gonna say that Jaco Pastorius goes on there without having to, he shouldn't be on the top five. That for me, that just goes there and that's it. That's like, boom, the huge, huge inspiration. So let's not take up the top five with someone who completely changed the face of the instrument more than anyone else in history. He deserves his own little spot over there. So Jaco, of course. Let's try and find five. I gotta say that Michel Indegiocello is one of my favorite bass players of all time. James Jamerson is such a huge influence on so many things and so many people, including Jaco. Jamerson has to be on there. I would say that Sting, because I was such a huge fan of The Police, and then later through seeing Sting live and realizing, you know, seeing some videos as well, realizing how much he's playing great bass lines and singing at the same time. So I would say Sting is probably up there. Paul McCartney as well, for the songwriting, for the bass playing, for the singing at the same time, for being an integral part of a band and still being such a huge voice. I have a lot of respect for that. And then on the jazz side, wow, it's just so complicated to boil that down into five people. The person who springs to mind, who is obviously just a world-class, innovative bass player on both electric and upright, is John Patitucci, and he's had a huge influence on me and my concept and my philosophies and the way I play and the action. People know this story, but more as a human being and just really influential and someone to aspire to, now that I'm fortunate enough to know him on a personal level and to be friends with John and to know who he is behind the bass. I think that's huge. You know, the bass playing is from another planet, of course. We all know this, we all know and love it and are influenced by it, I'm sure. But as a human being, that's a whole other depth of inspiration that, you know, I never knew James Jamerson or Paul, I don't know Paul McCartney or some of the other people. I don't know Sting. I don't know a lot of those people, but I do know John, and it would be remiss of me not to mention how much of an impact he's had on me, not only as a bass player, but as a human being. So huge Q&A vlog today. Thanks for sticking around. Thanks for your questions. There will be more. Yes, the podcast is coming back. New songbook is out. Links below for the play-alongs as well. You can get physical copies at Amazon. And if you buy physical copies at Amazon, you can go and get the digital play-alongs, the MP3s, at my e-store. All the links for that are below. Play-alongs for The Union, play-alongs for Theatre by the Sea, and all the songs in the songbook. All linked below. Check them out, and I will see you guys very soon.